So here is the chapter, we are not afraid to die if we can all be together. So what does this title suggest? What does the title suggest? It suggests the teamwork, importance of teamwork or the kind of work which we do in collaboration. So the work done collaboratively with the in coordination with others around us, then we are able to reach, we are able to realize, you know, that success which we always dream for or aspire for. Teamwork is important. So as a title, when you look at the title, it's written in inverted commas, we are not afraid to die, dash, 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 if we can all be together. So here, because of the inverted commas, you might have been able to make out like it's a dialogue. It's a quote, like somebody spoke this. So it's a character in the story who spoke this dialogue. So who are the characters of the story? The characters of the story are, number one, it's the narrator, Gordon Cook. Okay, so the story has been written by Gordon Cook and Alan East. And Gordon Cook is the narrator of the story also. So one character of the story is Gordon Cook, another is his wife, Mary, and third one is his son, Jonathan, and another one is his daughter, Suzanne. So these four main characters, and apart from that, there are two crewmen in the story. One is a Swiss and another is an American. That is, American is Larry Mitchell and Swiss is a Herb Sigler. So these six characters in the story are there. One more character, that is an inanimate character, that is Wave Walker, though it's not living, but Wave Walker would prove to be very, very, it would prove to be of great importance in the story, in this narrative, when we would be reading it. Because in the absence of the Wave Walker, this kind of adventurous journey might not ever have been possible. So that dialogue, you know, that title, we are not afraid to die if we can all be together, is a dialogue, okay, spoken by one of the characters that you'll find out very soon, right? So if we are all together, so even death becomes a pleasant experience, even death becomes something not to be afraid of when we are all together, okay? So here we read out like the narrator, Gordon Cook. He had already planned a voyage into the sea along with his wife. So for 16 years, they made preparation and they got a professionally built wave walker, that's a boat, and they went into the sea. The first leg of the journey from England to Plymouth, it went off well. From England to Cape Town, it went off well. And from Cape Town, that is from South Africa, they started for East, that is the South Indian Ocean. They knew that it would be the most, it would be the roughest sea or the ocean. So they hired two crewmen. One was an American and another was a Swiss. So then they started heading towards East. On the very second day, the weather started becoming atrocious. The winds were very strong. And the waves were equally alarming. Had it only been the winds, the narrator was not at all worried. But yes, when he saw that the waves were becoming quite alarming in size or in height, then he started becoming a bit, you know, that was a little unnerving for him. But anyway, till 25th of December, that is till Christmas, they managed and they were able to celebrate the festival with zeal. They were expecting that the weather might become better, but weather never became better. It started rather becoming worse. Even on the eve of New Year, it was quite atrocious weather. And on 2nd January, the weather was worst. Whether it is on 2nd January, the weather is worst, or on 3rd, or on 4th, or on 5th, that you people see. So we are going to read... We already read out like what happened on 2nd January. On 2nd January, their wave walker, that is the boat, was hit by a strong wave. So with that exploding wave, water came all over the ship, and even the narrator, he was thrown off board. Okay, but all of a sudden, when he popped out of water, he saw that his ship, which earlier had got upturned, which earlier had got, overturned, that very ship, by another wave, it had been made upright. Right? So first the ship had been, overturned by one wave, then another wave came and made the ship upright. And with the moment his ship became upright, narrator also felt a jerk in his lifelines, and he grabbed the guardrails and he went up to the deck of the ship, and from there he was able to manage to reach up to the wheel of the ship. So it was very important that he reaches the wheel of the ship. When the wheel is in the hands of the captain, then the captain is somehow able to manage the ship, or can at least give it some direction. Though at that time the whole ship was the deck of the ship, the floor of the ship, it was full of water. Yet he composed himself, he used his own presence of mind, and he started steering the ship forward. Even at this time, even at this kind of critical time, this man, which man? Gordon Cook. He was not out of wits. He still had the mind to think or to make strategy or to plan out like how to escape from this kind of situation. And it's not only Gordon Cook, it will be even his wife and even his children, and above all even the crewmen. They all would be doing their best to come out of this crisis successfully, right? So on 2nd Jan, at the dawn on 2nd Jan, so what had happened? A strong wave, a very terrific wave had hit their ship. And as a result, what had happened? And before the wave hit their ship, they had done their best to escape that terrific wave. They had already slowed down the speed of their ship. They had dropped the storm jib, and they had tied the back side of the ship with a heavy mooring rope. Okay, the purpose of tying the back side of the ship with a rope was that the ship doesn't, it doesn't shake, or it doesn't, come out into pieces. So, and afterwards they even got all ready, like in case the times would be critical. They got ready. Like, how did they get ready? They put on the lifelines. They put on they donned oilskins. Oilskins are waterproof jackets only, or you can say they put on those strong canvased clothes, which they might have made waterproof, thereby putting or applying oil on it. So it might be some waterproof clothes. They put on the lifelines, waterproof clothes, or the life jackets, and they got all the life raft drills ready and started waiting for any eventuality. Got it? So yesterday also I told you, like, if we want best, we should be prepared for the worst, right? So if we want the best to happen in our life, we should be ready for the worst. Only then the best would be, only then we'll be able to maintain the best. So then they started waiting for any eventuality. And the first indication of the impending disaster came at about 6 p.m. At 6 p.m., there was a signal that they got to know that now the disaster is going to happen. What was that indication? That indication was through an ominous silence. So that silence was an indicative of the fact, like, now something wrong is going to happen. So what was that silence? The wind stopped blowing. The sky grew dark. And then they realized that a cloud had canopied their ship. So it was actually not the cloud, it was actually a wave. So wave had almost covered their ship. And very soon, at that very time when they were like making out what it was, that very minute that wave exploded on their ship, and it was then that the crisis had actually occurred. So I realized with horror, I realized that it was not a cloud but a wave like no other I had ever seen. It appeared perfectly vertical and almost twice the height of the other waves, with a frightful breaking crest. So that was an indication that it was not the wave, it was not the cloud, it was a wave with a very, very horrible top. Like it had such a, its height was, you know, very, very horrible. The roar increased to a thunder as the stern moved up the face of the wave. And for a moment, I thought we might ride over it. But then a tremendous explosion shook the deck. A torrent of green and white water broke over the ship. My head smashed into the wheel, and I was aware of flying overboard and sinking below the waves. I accepted my approaching death, and as I was losing consciousness, I felt quite peaceful. So what had happened? The water or a wave had, exploded over the ship. And this author, you know, his head smashed into the wheel, and very soon he found himself, you know, floating over water. So he found himself flying overboard and sinking below the waves, meaning is that he was thrown off the ship. He was not in the ship, he was thrown off the ship by the waves. So by this time, he started becoming unconscious. And in that unconscious state, he started feeling comfortable. He started feeling at peace. Because when you are conscious, only then you make all efforts to survive. But when you are unconscious, then all the pain also goes off and you stop making any efforts. So when there is no effort, no pain. Pains are when you make efforts. Okay? But when you are not making any efforts, no pain. So he was feeling himself to be at peace. So unexpectedly, my head popped out of water a few meters away. Wave Walker was near capsizing, her mast almost horizontal. So when he was losing his consciousness, then all of a sudden, his head popped out of water and he saw that the Wave Walker was almost capsizing, that it had almost overturned. Okay, so at the mast of the ship had almost become horizontal, that is flat. The mast should be upright, but right now the mast had become totally flat on the water. So that was an indication that the ship was going to capsize. Then a wave hurled her upright. What is her? What is her here? What is her? Her is Wave Walker ship. So then one wave made the ship overturn. Another wave came and made the ship upright. That is straight. So ship became straight. My lifeline jerked taut. I grabbed the guardrails and sailed through the air into Wave Walker's main boom. Subsequent waves tossed me around the deck like a rag doll. My left ribs cracked, my mouth filled with blood and broken teeth. Somehow I found the wheel, lined up the stern for the next wave and hung her. So somehow he was able to come up to the wheel of the ship, right? Water, water everywhere. So all around, water was all around. Even in the ship, the water was there. I could feel that the ship had water below, but I dared not abandon the wheel to investigate. So why didn't he want to leave the wheel? Because it was very important as a captain to steer the wheel, because it was only the wheel which would make the ship in his control, which would keep the ship in his control. Because of the abundance of water in the ship or on the ship, if he would lose hold of the wheel, then maybe he would not be able to get back to this place. So though he wanted to see like how much water was there at the bottom part of the ship, but he could not leave the wheel. Suddenly the front hatch was thrown open and Mary appeared. "We are sinking," she screamed. "The decks are smashed and we are full of water." So meanwhile, when he was thinking about going downwards and when he wanted to check whether the bottom part of the ship was all right, his wife Mary. She opened up the hatch and door, and she announced that they were sinking and the ship was all full of water. So at this time, when his wife was telling him that they were sinking, so what could have been the like normal response of a normal husband? Like that kind of announcement that we are sinking, the whole ship is full of water. This kind of statement would have made any normal person to become afraid, and that very minute one would have thought, oh, we are sinking. Where are the kids? How are you? So, but at this time, the narrator used his presence of mind and he said, take the wheel. I shouted as I scrambled for the hatch. So instead of asking like, how are you? How will you manage? How are the kids? The narrator's words were, take the wheel. Means come and take the responsibility of the wheel. Stand by its side, because its most important thing at this time is to keep the ship sustained. So take the wheel, take control of the wheel. He shouted and he ordered his wife. And meanwhile, he literally scrambled. He literally crawled for the hatch. He literally crawled to take hold of the hatch. So because there was water all around. It was the moment of big crisis, yet this man did not lose his presence of mind. Number one, he gave responsibility of the wheel to his wife. Then instead of just jumping out, he scrambled himself and grabbed the hatch so that he does not get sloshed out into the water. Larry and Herb were pumping like madmen. So when he reached the bottom part of the ship, he found that Larry and Herb, those two crewmen, they were already pumping water out of the ship like madmen. Broken timbers hung at crazy angles. So broken pieces of the wood of the ship, they were hanging precariously. The whole starboard side bulged inwards. Starboard side is the right side of the ship. The right side of the ship, it was bulging inwards. Bulging means swelling inside. So the right side of the ship, it had got weak. That's why the right side of the ship was bulging inwards. Clothes, crockery, charts, tents, toys sloshed about in deep water. So everything, whatever was there in the ship, maybe the toys of the children, maybe the clothes, or maybe the crockery, everything was just floating about, sloshing about. I half swam, half crawled into the children's cabin. So from there, he reached the children's cabin. How did he reach there? It's not that he walked and reached there. He had to half swim and half crawl. And he reached up to the children's cabin. Are you all right? I asked. Yes, they answered from an upper bunk. But my head hurts a bit, said Sue, pointing to a big bump above her eyes. I had no time to worry about bumped heads. So when he reached up to the children, he asked them how are they, how they were. Then the first word the children said was like, yes, we are all right. But then his daughter, who was hardly 7 years old, she said like she had a bumped head and was hurting a little bit. It was, she pointed out like she pointed at her bumped head. But narrator had no time to bother about her bumped heads. Got it? So here the point is like we must bother about the priorities. What is priority? Like what is to be taken care of first? Right? At this time, what was more important? Survival was more important. Bumped heads can be cured later on. But that will happen only when you survive. So right now, the priority of narrator was to survive, was the safety of the family, and then the safety of the ship also. After finding a hammer, screws, and canvas, I struggled back on deck. So the narrator found all these instruments, all these weapons, hammer, screws, and canvas. I struggled back on deck. With the starboard side bashed open, we were taking water with each wave that broke over us. Now the starboard side, the right side of the ship, you know, it was bashed open. It was thrown open. Why the starboard side of the ship, you know, opened up? What happened to the starboard side of the ship? It bashed open. Why did it happen? Who can tell me like what happened to the starboard side of the ship? He says like it bashed open and we were taking water with each wave that broke over us. Now the water was coming from the starboard side of the ship. Okay, water kept coming from this right side of the ship because that side of the ship, you know, had broken. Why had that side broken? Because in the previous paragraph, we read out that the starboard side of the ship had already got weakened and it was already bulging inside. Now, the moment some wave came, the starboard side of the ship had broken. Okay. So now the water was coming inside with each wave. If I couldn't make some repairs, we would surely sink. So if they allowed water to come like that from that side of the ship, then it was sure that they would die. It was sure that they would sink. So what was the most important thing to be done right now, children? Raise hand if those who know the answer. What was the most important thing to be done right now? Come on. Come on. What was the most important thing to be done right now? Who will tell? Children, this is not the way. Come on, tell me. Okay, now raise hand if you don't know what I am asking you. Those who don't know the answer, they raise hand. Those who don't know the answer, they raise hand. Okay, Abhir, give the answer, roll number one. Abhir, give the answer. Abhay, give the answer. Okay, Amritpal, give the answer. Arshdeep Singh.
Yes, ma'am.
Aji, give the answer.
Ma'am, most important thing right now was to repair the wave buffer.
The most important thing was to repair the ship. But my point, like what was to be repaired? Your answer is correct. But what was to be repaired? Yes, Samriddhi, you're right. The most important thing was to stop the water from coming in. So the question is, there is one more child whose answer is correct. Samriddhi. Yes, Samriddhi, very, very correct answer. To repair the starboard side. So clap for Samriddhi. So Samriddhi, your answer is the best one, the most correct answer. My question was like, what was the most important thing to be done right now? Basically, the most important thing was to repair the starboard side of the ship. Why the starboard side had to be repaired right now? Because its one side had broken. And the water kept coming from with each wave. Okay, each wave was sending water inside the ship. And if the water is allowed to enter the ship like this, then very soon the ship would sink. The most important thing right now to be done was to repair the starboard side of the ship. Right? If we couldn't make some repairs, we would surely sink. So then he went, somehow I managed to stretch canvas and secure waterproof hatch covers across the gaping pools. So what he did, he managed to stretch the canvas and secure waterproof hatch covers across the gaping holes. So then the narrator, he tried to put the canvas covers or the waterproof covers across the gaping or the opened holes. Some water continued to stream below, but most of it was now being deflected over the site. So now he was able to cover up the holes with the help of waterproof covers. But even then, some water kept coming inside, but most of the water was being deflected back. Okay, so now they were able to stop about 80% of the water. 20% of water still kept coming inside, right? Because they covered the gaping holes with waterproof cover. But even then, some water continued to stream below, but most of it was now being deflected over the site. More problems arose when our hand pumps started to block up with the debris floating around the cabins and the electric pump short-circuited. So already, what were those crewmen doing? They were pumping out water from the ship. But now more problems started coming up because now those water, hand pumps started getting blocked because of the debris. What kind of debris? Which was floating all around the cabins. And even the electric pumps got short-circuited. So it's not that when they were trying to sort out the problems, then the problems were being sorted out very smoothly. No, they were doing their best, but the problems kept on coming side by side. Once they were able to repair the starboard side of the ship to some extent, then another problem came up was that their electric pumps got out of order because it got short-circuited, and even the pumps with which they were pumping water outside, they got blocked because of the debris which was floating all around. Got it? So the water level rose threateningly. The level of water was rising alarmingly inside. Back on deck, I found that our two spare hand pumps had been wrenched overboard, along with the foresail, the jib, the dinghies, and the main anchor. So then back on the deck, so narrator even found out that if the kind of spare hand pumps which they had, they also had been wrenched out. Along with the foresail, the jib, the dinghies, and the main anchor. So all these things, you know, they were out, they were not available with them now. Then I remembered we had another electric pump under the chart room floor. I connected it to an out pipe and was thankful to find that it worked. So finally, one electric pump which he remembered that it was there in the chart room, he got to know that there was one more electric pump and it was working. The night dragged on with an endless, bitterly cold routine of pumping, stirring, and working the radio throughout the night. Which night? Night of 2nd Jan. The whole night, 2nd January, they were able to pass off. Carry on. It was an endless night because when the time is good, then it has wings. Good time have wings. But when the time is bad, then even 1 minute seems to be like 100 hours, right? So the night dragged on with an endless, bitterly cold routine. So whole of the night, they kept on pumping water out, they kept on stirring, they kept on working the radio. What kind of working the radio? Like sending the signals. We were getting no replies to our Mayday calls. What are Mayday calls? The international call system, which is actually the radio signals. Okay, these are the radio signals which are used by the ships, by the captains in the ships, or by the aircrafts to send the signals of emergency. Okay, so these are the radio signals. So they were getting no replies to the Mayday calls. So the emergency signals which they were sending, they were not getting any response to that. And it was not something extraordinary because they were in the remotest corner of the world. in this kind of weather, in that kind of, you know, in that part of the world where there was no accessibility, it was expected that they would not be getting any response to their mayday calls. Sue's head had swollen alarmingly. She had two enormous black eyes, and now she showed us a deep cut on her arm. So Sue already had a swollen head, and now her head had become all the more swollen. Her head got swollen alarmingly, and she got one more cut on her arm. When I asked why she hadn't made more of her injuries before this, she replied, "I didn't want to worry you when you were trying to save us all." So father asked her, like, why didn't you tell me earlier about all these so many problems? Earlier when he went to her cabin, then he asked her, like, how she was. Then she had talked about her bumped head. But now she talked about her deep cut on her arm also. When father asked her, like, why didn't you tell me about this earlier? Then her answer was that, "I didn't want to bother you because I know that you were already trying to save us all." So children, it's like grown-ups were working, they were doing their best to survive this kind of crisis. But the children were no less. A 7-year-old child, a 6 and 7-year-old children, you know, even they were contributing their bit to survive this kind of crisis. So from the children's side, this kind of mental support, this kind of emotional support is, you know, is more than enough. Right? So Sue's head. So by morning on January 3, so 2nd Jan is over, and the 2nd Jan was a day when the crisis had hit them, when the whole ship had been smashed, and when the narrator had been, you know, badly injured, even the daughter was badly injured, and the whole ship was, you know, almost, it was like out of gear. Okay, the starboard side. Means a disaster had happened, or it had occurred on 2nd Jan. And now on 3rd, 4th and 5th January, they will keep on trying to survive the crisis which hit them on 2nd Jan. Okay, so by morning on January 3, the pumps had the water level sufficiently under control for us to take 2 hours rest in rotation.